Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Diane Geller, partner with Fox Rothschild. Diane provides strategic general counsel services to a wide array of public and private companies, both large and small, offering informed and experienced guidance on business and employment law issues that arise as a matter of operations. She has a particular focus on representing clients in the staffing industry. A former general counsel for a major public company in the staffing and funding industry, Diane is a seasoned practitioner who helps clients stay compliant with the ever-changing federal and state regulations governing the workplace, as well as the daily challenges facing business owners. Diane also provides consultative representation to businesses on a variety of transactions and employment-related matters, including drafting and negotiating employment contracts and mergers and acquisitions, licensing, and other business models. Fox Rothschild is a full-service national law firm with more than 900 lawyers in 27 offices coast to coast. The Fox national footprint has grown with an addition of 6 offices in the Southeast, including Atlanta, a move that expands the labor and employment team to more than 100 attorneys. Staffing professionals encounter legal compliance requirements daily while signing a new client or putting a candidate to work. In today's edition of the Industry Insider webinar series, Diane will provide an update on legal trends in 2019, including hot legal topics for the staffing industry, such as indemnification clauses, ADA, and web accessibility laws. By the end of the session, your staffing firm will be familiar with some of the top legal topics facing staffing firms in today's business environment. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat feature. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. With that, I will turn the floor over to Diane.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. It was very difficult when I was asked what the hot legal topics are for the staffing industry just to pick two, because we've got challenges both from the employment and from the business issue that regularly confront us. Before I start, I did, since this is being recorded, I did need to read the disclaimer that this presentation is for general purposes only. It doesn't constitute legal advice. I won't bore you with the rest of it. One of the two topics that I suggested that we talk about today are indemnification clauses. And the reason why I selected that is that I routinely get calls from clients in the staffing industry, which is the principal part of my practice, where they're being asked to sign indemnification clauses by their client. Very frequently, although they have their own staffing agreements, the client, especially if it's a larger company, is seeking to have the staffing company sign their agreement. Indemnification clauses is basically where one party agrees to, you might hear it, hold harmless, or defend the other party against future claims or losses. And the key that I want to express today is how dangerous this can be if you don't really know what you're signing. So I've given you a couple of top, points here as to items to look for when you're reading an indemnification clause. language such as arising out of or in connection with the services to be provided on the agreement. That becomes really troublesome because for the most part, we are not supervising the employees that are providing services to our clients. So to hold us harmless for to require us to hold them harmless for something arising out of or in connection with those services may not be a very fair measurement. Often there are phrases like any and all liabilities, any claim, cost, expense, any negligent acts, errors, omissions, or broad similar language. And the reason why that is not fair is that you're assuming many times responsibility for your client's business risks, not just yours. As a staffing company, normally your risks should be things like paying payroll, possibly performing a background check, performing drug testing, paying taxes, providing workers' compensation. All of those are reasonable risks to ask you as a staffing company to pick up. But asking you to pick up the liability for how the job is being done at the client's site when you're not responsible for supervising your staffers that are there becomes unreasonable. How do you know how many widgets they're putting into the box? You're not there. You haven't given them instructions as to how to pack and ship. Those are all being done by the client. So this is really a beware. In the case of selling staffing services, you need to beware of what you're signing. They are all over client-drafted contracts. Many people say, oh, well, the client will not change it. And I have many clients that will walk away from a business if, in fact, the client will not make any adjustments. More often than not, though, once there's a reasonable discussion about it and say, look, we're happy to be responsible for what we do, but we want you to be responsible for your part of it. It's not fair and reasonable or equitable to ask us to be responsible for your business risk. And I think that that's a real important issue when you're discussing it. You don't want to indemnify them for their product, for their supervision, for their bad acts. I have a client who's had to pick up discrimination claims because they signed a bad indemnification clause. And same thing with wage and hour violations where the client wasn't recording all the hours or telling their people not to record all the hours. Why would you want to pick up those liabilities? So I think that those are issues where you want them to be indemnifying you. If their person commits a discriminatory act, you should not be having to hold them harmless for it. Some of the things, as we mentioned before, payroll, taxes, workers' comp claims, unemployment, those are all reasonable items for you to be holding them harmless from. What I recommend to clients is considering having your language ready. You can do an addendum. If they won't consider using your contract, then suggest language to them. Just realize that you can't use it exactly the way you produce it simply because the definitions in the contract may not work. Once again, consider who's supervising the temporary employees. If you're not responsible for the acts or omissions of the work product, since they're under the supervision of the client, you shouldn't be responsible for that technical, professional, or similar services. You can't necessarily assess the quality of the work that your assigned employee is doing simply because you're not in the business that your client is in. And oftentimes they're very specialized. You also don't want to be responsible for actions taken by your assigned employee at the express or implied direction of the client. If the client is telling your person to do something in a certain way or has observed your assigned employee doing something in a particular fashion and then they haven't corrected it, why should you be responsible for the fact that when they were picking and packing, they put too few or too many products in, or they weren't wrapping it correctly. Part of this might be looking at listing the client's responsibility and then tying that indemnification by them to those responsibilities, kind of similar to what you're doing with the staffing company. Another important part of this is checking your insurance coverage. If you're going to accept the indemnification clause that's contained in the contract, you want to take a good hard look at your insurance clause and talk to your agent or the insurance company to see if you have coverage. Sometimes it's going to require you to add your client as an additional insured, and there's often a cost that's associated to that with that. So before you do it, you want to know whether you've got coverage and whether there's some magical language that you should be putting in your contract. Oftentimes, aside from the naming as additional insured, you want to be more specific in the kind of coverage that you're providing. Some of this, these indemnification clauses, by the way, can require you to pay for your assigned employee's injuries for a workers' comp claim, and then get sued by your client when the injured employee sues your client for the injury that they occurred due to some kind of negligence at the client. And now the client's going to come back to you and say, oh, you had an indemnification clause. So not only will you provide the coverage under your workers' comp, but now you've got to defend the client for their negligent act relative to your assigned employee. Very important that you limit who's reviewing and who can make decisions to sign agreements. It's not infrequent that I hear that a staffing company allows their sales rep or an account manager to sign contracts, and oftentimes those folks don't really understand the ramifications. You really need to make sure that the person who's signing it is aware of what they're signing and that they understand the risk. So, because they really are a bet the business kind of decision. So it's important to make the decision to assume the risk knowingly. Just here are some tips that you might want to consider. Aside from, you need to make sure that that indemnification clause is read, as well as the rest of the contract. And make sure you're clear on the language. If there's a huge difference between defending against reasonable claims and defending against all claims. But it can be easy to miss that distinction when you're reading the contract or if you're not reading it carefully enough. Consider limiting the scope of the indemnification clause. And that goes back to the language of what are you indemnifying them for? So you want to limit your responsibility. If you're not able to limit it, consider placing a cap on the amount you're going to pay out to the other party in the event of an indemnification. Possibly limiting it to the amount of your insurance coverage or a dollar amount. By placing the cap, at least you can quantify what exposure you have. And if the other party wants a broader warranty or a broader indemnification clause or a higher liability cap, then think about negotiating a higher hourly rate or a higher price for that contract in exchange for it. If you're dealing with professionals, certainly purchase professional indemnification insurance and check your general liability policy, because some exclude contracts and liability assumed under a contract. And then once again, either have a senior person at the company that's looking at these, and don't be afraid to call your outside or your in-house lawyer to look at it. These are just such significant exposures that they are a bet the business. Just a quick story that I would like to tell you, because it was a client of mine in the staffing industry. They placed IT professionals, and they were a subcontractor on a pretty good-sized contract with a pretty senior company that was the MSP on it. And they went and they placed one of their temporary employees. Actually, the person's sole responsibility was to change backup tapes. And this was in a pharmaceutical company. Well, at some point in time, after the guy had been there for probably a year, they get a call from the the MSP saying there's a problem. Well, what it turned out was that our temporary was pocketing a couple of these backup tapes every time that he left. And, you know, thinking that a pharmaceutical company would certainly have security, there was no security. So he put a couple in his raincoat, and he might put one or two in his lunch pail that he had or his briefcase, and off he would go. Now, the first thing that comes to mind is, oh, my goodness, we've got a data breach, which is, you know, a huge exposure. It's a huge exposure to the end client, which was a pharmaceutical company, and a huge exposure, obviously, to the temporary help company. Well, what happened here was that the pharmaceutical company was now making a demand for an excess of $3 million. Our guy didn't want the data on the tapes. All he wanted to do was to clean these backup tapes and resell them because he had a gambling issue. But it didn't matter. The pharmaceutical company had to comply with data breach requirements. They now have an out-of-sync backup system, so they don't know where the holes are. So they wanted the staffing company to pay to replace their entire backup system, as well as to pay for the legal fees and other damages. Now, what was interesting here was we had that full unrestricted indemnification clause, and that was definitely a bet the business kind of decision by signing that. Ultimately, the case did settle, but not after it cost our staffing company probably several hundred thousand dollars to get to it. And one of the big mistakes that they made, they actually had a greater indemnification clause to live by than the intermediary had to the end client. So there's lots of questions to ask and to make sure you truly understand what you're signing before you sign. So moving on to the other big topic that I wanted to discuss is that this is a hot new lawsuit. I know over the years we've all really suffered a little bit with some of the wage and hour lawsuits because they were very legal fee driven, and many of you may be aware of ADA lawsuits that there's testers who come in and say, well, your counter is too low so that a wheelchair can't fit beneath it, or that your entrance to your building is not accessible. And all those building and usage accessibility issues were all under Title III of the Americans with Disabilities Act. Well, Title III now has been expanded to look at not just premises accessibility, but website accessibility. So the theory behind it is that you can't impede the full use and enjoyment of the website, your website, by the disabled. And this started during the Obama administration. And previously, it was focused primarily on hotels, restaurants, supermarkets, and other similar establishments. Sitting here in Florida, one of the seminal cases was one involving Winn-Dixie, and it made some really hard and difficult law for companies to abide by and to fill. So an example of this would be how that your website needs to be screen readable, accessible by screen readers. And there's lots of different screen readers out there. So you would need to have an accessibility test of your website. So they've moved from the more typical places like movie theaters and restaurants and supermarkets to moving to service companies like the staffing companies. In fact, I just came back a couple of weeks ago from the staffing law conference in Washington, D.C., that's held by the American Staffing Association. And during that, I attended a legal and legislative meeting, and this was one of the hot topics there, is that a year or so ago, staffing companies were oblivious to it. Now it's starting to really come out of the woodwork towards service companies like staffing, and they're focusing on things like your online job postings. Can your applicants browse and review and apply for jobs on your website? Other job-related information that they need to know or complete both before and after hiring. So knowing that that your website is accessible and that someone going on to it can access and complete the information is really, really critical now. It's very attorney fee driven once again. I have a client that just received a letter from in Florida from a law firm in California saying, I represent a blind individual who lives in your state and has found that your website is not accessible to her. Please contact me regarding this matter. Now, you know that they want you to contact them because they're looking for you to not just make your website accessible, but really they're looking for you to pay money towards legal fees to settle the case. So it's definitely an attorney fee driven type of lawsuit. There's another one that just recently we were talking about at that staffing law, that a New York attorney had filed 30 actions within 30 days for the same individual. And these are 30 actions against different companies. So, you know, they're certainly out there. They're very financially driven. An additional issue to be concerned about is that the Department of Justice has started looking at the issue relative to online employment applications as well as other applications. So to the extent that you're using an online application, which many staffing companies do, you need to make sure it's accessible. And the way that they get to you is through Title III of the Americans with Disabilities Act, and it's because all companies, all private companies that are places of public accommodation, which is your office and your website, because it's open to the public, cannot discriminate and must not discriminate against individuals with disabilities and must allow full and equal enjoyment of the advantages. So that's the background of the lawsuit and how they get there. So all websites that in some states is that connect an individual to a physical location, and just an address on your website's enough, have to be disabled accessible. There's actually some division in the circuits, although most staffing companies do have a physical location that they advertise on their website, in addition to having a just having a web presence. But based upon what district, what federal court district you're in, you may or may not actually even need a physical address. So just having a website may be enough. And what it means is things like through the use of screen reader software and other tools that allow disabled people to access your website. It was originally thought that it was just going to be good enough to make it deal with the visually impaired. Well, cases have made it clear that it's all types of disabilities. So it's hearing, sight, speech, mobility, that your website has to be accessible with people with those various disabilities. And these are all a new wave of lawsuits. They're all being filed as we discussed. There are testers, like I mentioned to you in Florida, who describe themselves as an advocate for the disabled. There are people who are just coordinating with a disabled individual to bring these lawsuits. So they are there and they are happening more and more often. There's an interesting philosophy is how to deal with this, whether you get the letter and you correct the issue at the time you get the letter. I mean, obviously, it's better never to get the letter. Or do you wait till they sue you? Because once there is an indication you've been sued, then the next person knows that you've already done your correction, because you're going to do that as part of settling any kind of lawsuit. It's also a tremendous challenge because there's no clear regulations and guidance as to what meets the criteria. So there's no method of correction that if you do this and this, that's enough and you've now complied with the law. It involves things like resizing texts and captioning for videos, descriptions of the images so that someone who's blind can understand what's on the screen, the ability to use a keyboard to navigate the websites. All of those are part of what needs to be accessible. And we just, as I just mentioned, there's no federal guidelines. So without those federal guidelines specifying exactly what you need to do, there's just, we're using our best guess now. There's also no expectation that the regulations are going to come soon. So many courts have viewed, and most lawyers that are dealing in this area will tell you, to use the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines of WCAG 2.0, level AA or higher, and that's kind of the de facto standard for compliance. Those are issued by the World Wide Web Consortium. The other negative part of this is that courts have generally not been sympathetic to businesses, and they almost always settle. If the court finds your website inaccessible, it not only can order you to make it accessible, but the big dollar amount comes out of paying the plaintiff's attorney's fees and costs and expenses. It's been such a far-reaching length that attorneys have gone. They've done everything, including suing a television show who wants to be a millionaire, and they were doing that over the fact that they were not only they only had telephone screening, and since the show was in a theater, that was enough to make it a place of public accommodation. And since their telephones didn't allow equal access, that was enough to bring them into court. So the answer is that being forewarned and making those changes, making changes that allow people to complete your applications with who are visually or otherwise impaired, having captions on photos, video, and then it even comes down to the organization of the website's navigation. There have been some companies that have done a workaround in the meantime, using a 24-hour hotline, some other type of remote access, and making applications or other documents available by other means. I think that most of the courts are looking for you to show a commitment to solving those accessibility issues. And, as long as you have a brick and mortar, you're pretty much stuck. And if you happen to be in some of those districts, which if you would like them, I'm happy to make them available, just email me, that you might be able to escape it if you're just working without a physical location that you list to the public. So we talked about this, that's adding the captions and photos and videos and organizing, the need to show a good faith effort. All of those make a huge difference. We talked about, and this is really disturbing because I think it's going to certainly reach the industry, and that is the new United States Department of Justice attention. If you Google it, you'll find some information on it. They've already issued an informal guidance that tends to suggest that they're going to be looking at this issue, and that it not only violates Title I, which is the ADA section that we all are accustomed to, but they are tying the violation or the inaccessibility or the unaccessibility of your website to a violation of Title I of the ADA, in that it results in discrimination in hiring, since people who have a disability can't access your website and fill out your application. Therefore, you're discriminating in your hiring and violating Title I of the ADA. So that is really troubling, and you know, we're waiting to see where that goes. I know this is kind of a little bit of a shorter presentation than TRICOM usually has. I felt it was really critical to touch those two issues. I'm happy to answer any questions on those or similar staffing industry legal issues over the next few minutes.
Diane, thank you for sharing that and you know, getting us up to speed on some of the new issues that are affecting staffing companies when it comes to employment-related matters. Can you tell me your best suggestion for staffing companies to go about helping to correct the two hot ones that we talked about? One, you know, what's the best practice for the indemnification clauses and to protect yourself there, and maybe the best practice of how to make yourself compliant for this new ADA web accessibility laws?
Sure, absolutely. Well, I think that the indemnification clause issue has been one that's been troubling the industry for a long time, and it troubles other types of businesses too. I think that there's ways to, first of all, try and use your own contract as opposed to signing a client contract when that's possible, and make sure that your contract addresses that indemnification clearly or head on, so that you can limit your liability from that perspective. Be careful who's reading and making decisions on client contracts. It's something that you really don't want to push too far down in your organization. You really want a more senior person making the decision whether the contract is worth it, not just in terms of what your markup, but in terms of what other liability they're asking you to assume under the contract. There's some language that I like to talk about being, it's not really magical, but magical language that you may want to start putting into your agreements if, in fact, you're required to accept a broader form indemnification. The reason being that you may be able to then work with your insurance agent to get coverage for those indemnifications that you feel you need to accept. Limit the scope of the indemnification, not just as to what kind of indemnification that you're providing, but also limit it to the amount of the insurance that you have it. Put a cap on it. I ran into an issue a couple of months ago for a client with an indemnification, a broad indemnification he gave the client. And, you know, while we were able to wiggle our way around an insurance company declining coverage, we did determine that the best way in this case, it was an employment practices liability matter, that in the future now, if we're going to provide that kind of coverage, we specifically say it in the agreement that we're going to name them on our employment practices liability. That, in his case, would then meet the provisions of his policy, and the policy would have to pick up that coverage. But remember, every time you cover a claim, and I think this is really critical, every claim that you cover is costing you money. Not just the issue with the client relationship or the deductible, but it's also going to affect the rating on your policy when it comes up for renewal. There are clients that can't get renewals on their EPLI insurance because they paid out substantial money, or their policy went up in premium substantially as a result of it. So that's why it's so important to understand the liability that you're picking up and the risk that you're picking up when you're signing indemnification clauses. It's okay to accept those risks that are inherent in your business. It's up to you to make sure that your temporary employees are getting paid. It's up to you to make sure that you're filing taxes oftentimes now over the last several years since the Affordable Care Act went into effect, that's another indemnification that you're being asked to give. So if you're doing that, you want to make sure not just that your process is correct internally, but that you know what you're accepting. And there are certain ways to draft your documents and to work with your insurance coverage and to provide coverage for it and to, you know, limit the risk that's going to be a bet the business kind of risk. From the website accessibility, the best thing that you can do now is to have your website tested. If you don't know whether or not it's accessible, if you're using a website development company, there's software that's available that can run a test on your website to see if it's accessible without you having to go out and buy a screen reader or have somebody with a screen reader. You should be working with a good website developer who can test that. And then if they find it not to be, which unfortunately in most cases they haven't been developed to deal with the accessibility issue, some of the big front end and back end suppliers that you use may in fact have that, but you need to check with them. And you need to make sure that when they're testing and for screen reader software, they're testing it to make sure that it can read the video, it tells you the captions to the photos, that someone can fill out your application form verbally without, if they've got the correct equipment, and don't have to be able to sit there and type or see it, that it will tell them what lines to be filling out or what information is needed. That's all very critical. And then make sure that when your website developer, after they've tested it and they decide that it's time to, you need to make some changes, is have them make sure that it's WCAG 2.0 AA or higher. That way, if you've met that criteria that the World Wide Web Consortium publishes, at least you've made a good faith effort. And testing it and moving forward also shows courts that you've made a good faith effort. Especially if you're willing to commit to some other kinds of accessibility plans in the interim. If you remember, we all probably, and it still exists, in buildings that are not readily accessible that haven't had to be made accessible by law, you used to see doorbells or call this phone number if you need assistance entering. Well, there are some workarounds. They're not easy and they're not perfect, but consider using a workaround temporarily until you can make sure that your website is accessible. But definitely move forward to do it. It is the hot lawsuit. While I'm still seeing a goodly number of wage and hour suits, I'm seeing as many, and in some cases more, website accessibility lawsuits, because they're much easier to get in and out of for the plaintiff's lawyer than having to actually litigate through a wage and hour suit.
Wonderful. We do have another question that's come in, and it's, do you have a sample indemnification clause that you can share which protects staffing companies and has language of extent of liability?
I don't really have one, because it's oftentimes I tailor it. If you're a member of the American Staffing Association, they have some samples online. Frankly, even theirs I tend to tweak a little bit. But I think if you're working to do it, what you want to do is list the topics and the items that you're willing to stand by, and then make sure that the requirements that you want your client to have are listed out in the contract. I usually just cross-reference my indemnification clause back to the fact that we as the staffing company are going to be responsible for the items listed in paragraph 1A and you as the client are going to be responsible for everything in 2B forward. And that way, you can also, if you're in an issue where you've got dealing with OSHA, you can make sure all of those issues are covered. It depends a little bit on the kind of staffing you do in terms of what you want to require from the client, but for sure, don't reach out to do more than what you're doing as a staffing company. And if you contact me, I'm happy to give you some other ideas.
Wonderful. And your contact information is up on the screen now, both a phone number and an email address. Again, if you have any other questions, feel free to submit them. If you would like to have any additional questions answered regarding legal advice, Diana is great. Feel free to reach out to her offline, if not in the WebEx session today. I'll also go ahead at this point and open up the floor for some polling. I'd like to get your feedback on the session and other topics that you might be interested in hearing for future sessions. Again, that helps us. Diane, do you have any final thoughts that you'd like to share before we wrap things up today?
Yes, I'd like to suggest two things. One, first of all, I'm happy if you want to email me a question. Please do that, and I will try and answer it as best that I can. Secondly, I can't encourage people enough to make sure that when they're using professionals, whether it's funding companies, whether it's accountants, whether it's attorneys, make sure it's people that really know your business. You know, don't go to a real estate lawyer and think that they're going to be able to give you, good answers to questions related to the industry. And, same thing with funding. It's much better when you use a funding company that knows the industry. And same thing with accountants. Go and make sure you have an accountant that understands the industry. Having professionals in your corner is so important. Not just while you're doing business, but also at the time that you decide to sell your business, is having the right professionals is incredibly important.
I completely agree with that statement. The people who know their niche and their industry are going to give you the best advice. Again, thank you all for joining us in today's session. Legal topics for the staffing industry. We'll have a recording of the webinar available on our website. You can find that at www.tricom.com, and it's in the Industry Insiders webinar tab. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next webinar session. Have a wonderful day. Thanks so much for joining us.